discussing news and issues in orthopedics and spine healthcare. This is Spine Talk.
Hi, this is Dr. John Shim, and today we're going to talk about the topic of deep venous thrombosis and spinal surgery. I have Jason Mazur, orthopedic assistant, here with me, and he's going to review an article called Risk Factors and Pharmacologic Prophylaxis for Venous Thromboembolism in Elective Spinal Surgery, published in the Journal of Spine in 2018. Jason, can you tell us about this article?
Yeah, so this study comes to us from Yale University. This was a retrospective study that was performed. The authors of the study took a look at a huge database of 109,000 plus patients from elective spine surgery over the course of about a 9-year period, in addition to looking at one institution of 2,855 patients over a course of a 3-year period. The incidence of venous thromboembolism in the database was 0.61%. At the academic center, it was twice that. It was 1.23%. At the academic center, they did point out that all of the patients were also given sequential compression devices and early ambulation to help, again, minimize the risk of VTE. The results of the study, somewhat interesting. Their independent risk factors for VTE were determined to be greater age, male gender, increased body mass index, dependent functional status, lumbar spine surgery, longer operative times, longer lengths of stay, and other postoperative complications. Kind of the bottom line from this, though, is that pharmacologic prophylaxis did not significantly influence the rate of VTE with associated increase, though, in risk of epidural hematoma following surgery and return back to the operating room. So, Dr. Shim, this, again, a kind of a little bit controversial issue with this. When we talk about general orthopedic surgery, when we talk about like hips and knee replacements and hip fractures, we know that the risk of VTE is very high, and there is a kind of a standard set of guidelines or kind of a general standard that we follow in providing patients prophylaxis. When it comes to spine surgery, though, the risk a little bit lower, but we're doing a kind of multitude of different types of cases where the risks may vary, and there is no standard present. So it comes down, I guess, to the surgeon determining if pharmacologic therapy or prophylaxis is necessary. From your perspective, what do you look at in a patient's history, or what other factors do you consider in whether to determine if the patient needs prophylaxis or not?
Well, I think we got to go back a few steps to have this discussion for our listening audience, for our patients. VTE, we're going to use medical jargon, but really what we're talking about, blood clots that typically come from your legs, and those blood clots can travel. They can travel to your lungs and cause some pretty bad things. You can have something called a pulmonary embolus where the blood clot basically stops the blood flow into your lungs, and it can be a really bad problem, and actually some people can die from that process. So this is a really significant problem as orthopedic surgeons doing hip replacements, knee replacements, and trauma care. It's a big problem because the number of people who develop these blood clots to the legs are pretty significant. That's why there's lots of information about how to prevent it, what kind of treatments we can do. We can give medications, we can give blood thinners, we can even, for some really sick patients, they even talk about putting these things called umbrella devices to try to capture the blood clots as they travel up towards your lungs. We know it's a problem in orthopedics. Is it a problem in spinal surgery? I think one of the things that's coming out of the study is there are risk factors. Well, these are the same risk factors that anybody has to develop blood clots. I mean, I'm sure you know, we've taken care of patients before. There are certain patients who are susceptible to blood clots, and we're very concerned about it. We know that ahead of time. So the question is, how do you counsel these people, and what do we do for them? So what is your perspective on this, Jason? Because for me, it tells me it's more about patient selection than anything else. We have to choose people with the lowest risk to perform the surgeries to decrease the chance of having these problems. If they're higher risk, we have to spend a fair amount of time counseling them. Sure. What is your takeaway when you read this?
No, I agree that it's kind of a more of a individualized approach, especially when it comes to elective spine surgery. By kind of doing a standard set of guidelines, I don't think it would ever work. Even just across, if we look at just like lumbar surgeries, there are certain procedures, regular, general, healthy patients, yes, there's always going to be a risk of VTE, but the risk may be greater in trying to prevent that risk. So I think that to me, from reading the, just this article, not looking at the other literature, I would take away from this that it has to be an individualized approach again. And as you mentioned, there are certain risk factors that we know raise those risks up considerably, and those are the people that we really have to look at closely.
Well, the other thing that the article also points out is there's risks associated with using these pharmacologic agents. These are blood thinners. So as spinal surgeons, one of the biggest concerns we have is development of blood clots near the nerves, near the spinal cord, and that blood clot expands and causes more pressure and then causes another set of complications and problems. The study does show that there is some risk to using these pharmacologic agents. So again, we have to weigh the risks. There's a risk of developing blood clots. There's a risk of having complications. Again, a lot of this comes down to patient selection. In other words, what is that person like? If they have an increased age, if they're obese, if they've had a history of blood clots, if they have a history of some sort of condition, like cancer, for instance. Cancer has increased rates of blood clots and whatnot. Mm-hmm. We have to consider all these things while we have the discussion with patients about doing surgery. A lot of the surgeries we do are elective. In other words, there's a choice. Mm-hmm. So are patients being properly counseled? Are they going in with eyes wide open about these risk factors? There's, let alone the standard risk factors of any surgery, now there's also risk factors of blood clots. Again, it's always, to me, a discussion about their overall patient status. It's individualized to the patient. The science is never perfect in that the science experiments that are being done are perfect scenarios where you have everything exactly the same except one condition, and you try to differentiate that one condition. Taking care of patients, we know that doesn't actually exist. So to me, that's where it's the art of medicine versus the science of research kind of has to intersect. So from your standpoint, reading this, you see our patient population. We haven't really done this chemical prophylaxis in our patients because we're taking care of healthier patients or we're doing smaller surgeries. Do you see anywhere where we probably could consider or should consider using these medications?
I guess for potentially if we were kind of going outside of our patient population, maybe the large lumbar cases, again, where they have some of these known risk factors, then it would have to be, again, a discussion of risks and benefits. Is, does the risk of giving them prophylaxis outweigh, or the benefit, excuse me, of giving them prophylaxis outweigh the risk of them developing some interoperative or postoperative complications?
One of the things that I was kind of looking for in the study and I didn't quite see is dissecting out our non-pharmacologic treatments actually beneficial. A lot of patients have what's called SCDs, sequential compression devices applied to their legs. It actually squeezes their legs and have the blood flow through their veins. So theoretically allows more circulation, so less development of blood clots. Sure. A certain number of patients in these studies were using those mechanical compression devices and some were not. Mm-hmm. I don't recall them stripping this out for us to really understand, is that an independent factor? We can share with our patients that we actually use SCD devices on most of our patients who require lumbar surgery, not so much for the smaller ones, but certainly the longer operations. It's pretty standard for us to do. I was surprised they actually didn't dissect that down. So, my concern is we do things for patients because we've always done it that way. The question is that actually really what happens? Does that really benefit people or not? So, we have to think of ourselves and be retrospective in what we do and hope that our conventions are still beneficial to patients.
All right.
So, this is Dr. Shem here with Jason Mazza talking about deep venous thrombosis in spinal surgery and the ramifications of using medications to try to control it. I hope this is informative. If you have any issues about this and have concerns, please discuss this with your surgeon before you have your operation. Have a good day.